This is Urban Agriculture, episode number 9, Green Spirit Farms.
This is Urban Agriculture, episode number 9, recorded on September 24th, 2014. Hey, everybody. I'm Vincent Racaniello, and with me is Dickson Despommier.
Hello, Vincent.
How are you, Dickson?
I'm excited.
What are you excited about?
Well, we get our second interview for a commercial grower.
It is pretty exciting. There are two vertical farms in the world.
At least.
Well, this is a remote interview.
It is.
And
we've got some noises off that we'll probably have to deal with.
Noises off. That's a stage thing, isn't it?
Yes, it certainly is. And so I'm hearing some background noise.
I forgot to shut a fan off.
we don't want to turn any fans off. We love everybody. Oh, my goodness. That makes a huge difference.
It's a beautiful view we have. For those of us listening, we do have a video with this episode.
Right.
Well, we hope we will.
Sure,
and
we will.
You can see the wonderful racks of plants. So our guests today are from Green Spirit Farms, Milan Kluko and Daniel Kluko. Welcome, guys.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
And they are sitting inside of Green Spirits Farms, which is in Michigan. Exactly where in Michigan are you guys?
New Buffalo, Michigan. It's as far southwest as you can get in Michigan.
Right. I like to say exit 1.
on which route?
Exit 1.
Across the lake from Chicago.
He disappeared, didn't he?
He did. So how about if you guys sit just a little bit closer to the microphone?
Get cozy with the computer.
Yeah.
This way, Dan. Yep.
Beautiful.
That's perfect.
You guys look great, and the plants behind you look great. And we'll talk about those in a minute, but let's start by finding out, where are you guys from? You born in Michigan?
I'm originally from, born and raised in Chicago.
Ah.
I moved out here. New Buffalo is a resort community from Chicago, so it's about 65 miles, 70 miles. A lot of second homeowners. Mm-hmm. I moved out here full-time in 1996, and Dan moved out here
2011.
There you go.
And Dan, of course, is your son, right?
Correct. I'm sorry. Yes.
This is a family business. So you own Green Spirit Farm. Is that correct, Milan?
Yes. You're talking to actually two of the owners here. Dan's a minority owner as well.
All right,
nice.
Dan.
Nice.
You're like 14 years old, Dan, right?
He lied when he went to the pub in England.
you look really young. Well, actually, your dad looks young too. You're about 45, I'd guess. So how did you get involved? Tell us a little bit about your background. What did you do after you were born?
Besides breathe.
Go ahead. Okay. I ate a lot and I slept a lot. First thing.
This is good.
Still does. Still does.
I went to Lyons Township High School in LaGrange, Illinois, and then moved to Traverse City, Michigan. Where I went to high school, and then I went to the community college, Traverse City Community College up there for pursuing computer science, which is a big interest of mine. Built computers when I was 11, started doing that, been a big passion, still is. But kind of lost interest in the field while I was in college. Decided I want to figure out what to do with life, so I went and moved down with my dad and started working for his engineering firm, Fountainhead Engineering. And then he had this wacky idea to get vegetables in a warehouse. Started real small, had a couple rotary gardens, the Volks Gardens from Omega Gardens was our first system. And threw some lights in, threw some nutrients, and then had to figure out the rest. And that's the short story.
Okay. Milan, how about you?
Let's see. The short story is I didn't sleep as much. I didn't eat as much. I've been involved in engineering and I guess the environmental sciences since my junior year in college. when I started my first consulting business. I co-authored the first solid waste management plan for the city of Chicago back in 1983, by the way, which just was starting to be implemented last year, so it takes a little bit longer. But I had a couple of successful consulting businesses that I sold, mostly in the solid waste recycling and pulp and paper business, of all things. So I had a background by trained education. I'm a hydrogeologist. That's a geologist that studies a lot on water and water supply. With a lot of the contamination assessments that we started doing under Superfund and those things in the early 80s, I sort of learned by doing, so I became became pretty proficient at doing environmental investigations. Along the way, we looked at soil erosion, stormwater issues from an engineering perspective, and I always tended towards more low-impact development and more naturalized systems. But developed composting facilities. I did the first one in Illinois. A bunch across the United States, some food composting facilities out west in the Northwest. And one thing led to another, and I started Fountainhead Engineering after I sold my last company in 1998. And through Fountainhead Engineering, we started doing the assessments for indoor growing. And the key was light, and I give Dan all the credit for the light, because the high-pressure sodium, the metal halide lamps, very high wattage, a lot of heat. And if you see behind us, the bright white light you see that we're using currently was invented by Nikola Tesla back in the 1890s. So Dan also forget to mention he was a Tesla freak. So I'm not sure if it was a good idea or what.
You chose well.
So those lights in the back of us, we applied them for doing Green Spirit Farms. So we founded Green Spirit Farms separate from the engineering company on 11-11-11. Taking advantage of the synergy of those numbers. And we haven't looked back. It's been an interesting ride. I think we've done some, with Dan's help and other people's help, some innovative things. And, that's about 30 years of my life.
How did you hear of Dickson de Pommier?
Well, it's interesting you should say that, because I want to make sure that he understands that I bought one of his books.
I this was without coaching, by the way. I want everyone to know that there's no commercial aspect to this, non-ad whatsoever.
So had you seen his book before you started Green Spirit Farms?
No, as a matter of fact, what happened was is when I told people we were doing controlled environment agriculture, they said, "What's that?" And I said, "It's indoor farming." And they said, "Oh, I have a book on that." I'm like, "Really?" And so for a present, and Dick, there's about three or four people that bought this book for me and gave it to me. So yes. I did my own version, but other people thought I should read your book. And and also really did, and we talked about this in Nottingham a couple of weeks ago at the University of Nottingham, it sort of coalesced sort of a movement in a direction that was sort of fragmented. And what we did was look at the same type of issues, but we did it much more low tech. And because of our engineering background and looking at brownfield redevelopment, old industrial buildings were vacant, if Dan hadn't come across with this induction lighting and applied it to our systems you see behind, we wouldn't have been able to do these kind of things. But we looked at going into underutilized buildings, and after 2008 and 2009, there seemed to be a lot of them. Take advantage of this cheap space, because space has to be cheap, and to get criticality out of a system. And like Dan said, initially we were using the Omega Rotary Gardens, and they're cylinder wheels. We grow mostly flowering plants in those. Don't use them much anymore, because now we get plant densities anywhere from 15 to 50 plants per square foot.
Wow.
So that's the key. It's about net revenue per square foot.
Yes.
It's about having a harvest. We're 21 days now on most of our greens.
Wow.
17 harvests a year. We use 98% less water, 96% less land. We're where the people are at, so we're located just outside of Chicago. So we offset all that carbon on the vegetables that are being transported from California, and they make a stop in Chicago, Philadelphia, on their way to New York. So from an ecosystem performance standpoint, we're much better, no runoff. We're all a self-contained facility. But the thing that we do the best, and I think, Dick, we talked about this a little bit, but someone kept on asking me, how can you describe what you do best as a vertical farmer? And I thought about that, and risk management. That's really what we are. We're better risk managers because we take weather out of the equation.
So tell us a little bit about the facility. Where did you get it? What it was before, and what it looks like inside.
Yeah, it was formerly a plastic injection mold facility. Mm-hmm. So it was already retrofitted to dissipate heat. Probably the largest building in the small town of Buffalo.
Population, so not a big town. We're on the outskirts, and was the only employer.
Sorry, what was the population? I missed that.
2,500.
2,500.
Wow. During the winter, the summertime is 20,000 probably.
Most, 50% second homes in the area. So, but the building we're in now is vacant for about 12 years, I think.
Correct.
And it employed a lot of people in the area. It was a big employer. So when it went out of business, it just kind of sat here for a while. And then there was a glass company that was in before us, and
for about 4 months, and they unfortunately were a victim, I think, of the 2008-09 financial fiasco.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
They went bankrupt, and we power washed, painted, and moved in 30 days later, and had our first harvest 30 days after that.
Wow.
Yeah.
So is it one big open space I see behind you?
It is two large spaces connected by a large hole in the wall.
Mm-hmm. It's one story, right?
Right. It's one story. We're about 18 feet under the beam that holds up the roof, so it's a 20-foot ceiling, more or less. But the clear space would be 18 feet, and we actually had to put that hole in the wall.
Mm. Right.
To connect two sections.
And inside, I can see a rack with 1, 2, 3, 4 levels of growing area. Is that correct, or are there more?
Yep, that is correct. 4 levels, and we refer to each 4 level as a VGS, which is a vertical growing system.
Hmm.
Big on acronyms.
Join the group.
And
one VGS contains 1,016 heads of lettuce.
Wow.
It's in a 9 by 6 footage square, 9 by 6 areas, 36 square feet.
Right.
So it's just under 50 plants a square foot.
Are you growing the same plants on all 4 levels, or do you have different plants?
We do a mix that we sell to the supermarket, so each level is a different variety of lettuce.
Got it.
So it's all lettuce that you're growing, right?
Lettuce and basil. We also have spinach growing and kale to be seeded.
And bok choy. We just started planting bok choy as well.
Wow. So each level has its own lighting, is that correct?
Yes.
And the lighting is on the bottom of the level above it, right?
Correct, yep. And the light broadcasts a footprint over a 4x8 tray, standard FDA-approved, plastics.
Mm-hmm.
And go ahead.
What kind of lights are those?
Those are induction lamps. They're filamentless and they're electroless. Like Milan said, they're invented in 1891.
That's direct current, right?
Yeah. There's 2 electromagnets on either end excite an argon gas that's housed within the lamp.
Oh, look at this.
Well, look, Milan just went and picked 2 leaves. And that's lettuce?
That's basil.
Basil.
Hey, what do I know? Italian.
No. It looks like lettuce because it's so big
and
robust.
Huge. It's beautiful. Yeah.
Fantastic.
I bet it smells great, right?
Yeah, that's what's coming next. So there's a relative size. So we only sell the leaves because we keep that plant alive for how many harvests?
Seven or eight.
Wow. 7 or 8 harvests.
Fantastic.
And you only eat leaves when you cook.
Yeah, unfortunately,
he just ate one because
that's right.
It's not dirty, right? There's no dirt. There are no insects on it.
Right, no soil. We grow in rockwool. That's the medium we use, and we only use 1-inch plugs, so we only seed in the rockwool.
So, for the non-technical people, rockwool is
basalt, basically. It's
basalt. It's a volcanic deposit, right?
Volcanic rock. Yeah, it's
okay.
Crush heated to 1,800 degrees and spun like cotton candy.
And there's no nutrients whatsoever in it, so you have to add all the nutrients yourself. Correct.
Yes, exactly. Completely inert. So the nutrients are in the water, and the rock will absorbs that.
So that's just a substrate for the root systems.
Yes, precisely.
Terrific.
Daniel, behind you, there are... Oh, what do we got here?
We got the packaged basil.
Nice.
This is actually the spirit mix.
Lovely. Look at that. Come on, we already had lunch, but I wish I could have lunch again, and it's beautiful. Could put some nice dressing on that and just eat it right out of the package.
And as Dan was saying, this is the different lettuces that are grown, and we harvest it. I'm sorry, I'm trying to do this.
Yeah, you see, it's beautiful.
Eat that stuff, Dick.
It's gorgeous.
What happens is we harvest this as a spirit mix. So when it's harvested, it goes here into our supply chain, packaged for retail sales. And that's planted the same day. It's replanted the same day it's harvested with a new crop.
So how old is the vegetable matter inside that container right now?
It's 21 days old. It was cut probably 2 hours ago.
Yeah, 2 hours ago.
Oh, no, that's what I meant. So it's two-hour-old food, basically.
Yep. And this will be in the supermarket today.
And it'll be gone, too, I assume. Yep. I'm assuming. Great.
So who picks those? You have people who do that, or you do it yourselves?
Yeah, well, we used to do it ourselves, and now we do a lot less of that, but we do have a staff that runs the farm, and I know they're busy right now, but I'm hoping I can bring everyone in on camera later.
That'd be great.
So do they pick it into a basket, and then later you divide it into the plastic containers?
Yeah, precisely. So basically, how we harvest is we use a scissor lift to go up to the top levels.
Wow.
Everything's in a sectionalized foam.
You're tempting us, Milan. This is not fair. This is really not fair.
That's the type of spinach. We
Try
that as a burgundy vein or red vein spinach.
Nice, yeah, it's beautiful.
Cool.
Yeah, those of you not watching the video, you should really, because these guys, not only are they handsome, but the greenery is gorgeous. I'm sorry, go ahead, Daniel. What were you saying about the harvest?
The tray is full of water, right? And then foam board is on top of the water. And then in holes in the foam board is the rock wool plugs. And then the roots go through that into the water. Very standard in hydroponics.
What a great segue, right?
Look at that. It's perfect.
And what are you feeding them?
And then there's the root.
Yeah, it's a beautiful root.
Just elements, you know, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, all the micro elements. I mean, it's not organic in any way.
So you have a shelf full of chemicals, and you mix them together in a certain way, and then that's your diet.
Nutrients. Well, chemical has a bad connotation.
Yeah, elements. Okay, elements.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what it is. We make a stock tank that's a concentrated solution of those elements, and then we add it to a lot of water to dilute it to the yeast.
Sure.
Wants to run the crops.
What do you use as an organic source of nitrogen?
What's that?
What's left over after
it's almost 100% nitrate.
Nitrate, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And what you're showing us left over, that you leave in the water and it will grow again, right?
Well, it could, but what we do is because it's a 21-day cycle, we do cut and come again with some of our spinach and kale.
Yeah.
But this is all pulled, and if you look at the root development, that's about 14 inches.
Yeah. It's amazing.
And this is all grown in 3/4 of an inch of water.
Man, it's beautiful.
That's the system for, I pulled this from this guy here.
Yes, right over here.
It's been about 9 days in that system.
Wow. Yeah. Have you figured out a use for that part of the plant that you don't sell?
We actually donate all our waste, exclusive of the rock wool, to a local farmer who composts it.
Great.
Yeah, which is this. And then for some of this, that's what's left over.
Right.
And this holds 16 times its weight in water. So the plant gets nutrients when it wants it on its schedule. And obviously the nice white roots tell you that we're doing a
great
job.
Right.
And if you could taste it, you would agree.
Sure.
You know, it's funny you should be eating, Milan, because we have a letter here from a listener in France, and he says he's worried about the taste of, vegetables grown in water and vertical farms. How does that stuff taste? Is it great?
It's the best.
It's the best.
Why do you think those guys are so handsome? This is what they've been eating for the last 2 years.
And I speak of vertical farming. People that know me or people that have heard me speak before come up to me and say, you really need to tell people how good it tastes. And it's kind of self-serving to do that, but we're not kidding. It tastes great, and our customers tell us that. They send us emails. They send the stores emails because when you look about sustainability, however you want to define sustainability, we look at sustainability as to keep something going, right, for the next generation. And the way you do that is develop something that people want.
Hear, hear.
And as good as our story is, and it's great, And is but the theory of the story comes from vertical farming, right? And if it doesn't taste good, it's not sustainable. So
That's right.
And he's done a nice job with these nutrients, mixing them together. He needs to take a little bit more credit for that. And adding some, you know, the little micronutrients and coming up with the environment that we have, you see behind us, that we do a lot of interesting things to emulate what happens outside. We just do it inside without the risk of weather, right?
I wanted to ask you, Daniel, when you make these formulations to feed the plants, did you do any experimenting or did you start with something that was published already?
Yeah, I mean, the beginning was purely experimentation. I mean, in the purest sense of the word.
When he was a kid, he would ask me for $10 to go buy stuff. Now it just happens in increments of thousands.
Yeah. Then I have to justify the return on that as well.
There you go.
But really, it was I took a lot of information from Cornell University. Has a good CA program.
That's Vincent's alma mater, by the way. Nice mention.
Yeah. Very succinct information. Very specific. I appreciated it tremendously. You know, I bought a lot of books early on. Howard M. Resch's book, Hydroponic Vegetable Production, was the first one. You know, my dad already had Dickson's book, so I didn't need to buy that.
There's not too much really hands-on information in that book, I must add.
but again, what you look at when you're molding young minds, if I could use that term, which I don't know that I'm able to do that. What Dan did was have no fear in developing the system. I had to work around developing the business model, and at some point the two meet, right? And the growing, and you heard him say about getting a return. You need to get a reasonable return to do good in life.
Yeah.
Not a return, a reasonable return. And if we can help the people in California keep their water in California for California purposes, and we can keep that carbon out of the atmosphere, and we can keep less, you know, stuff getting into our rivers, lakes, and streams. We're part of an agricultural system. We're not going to replace an agricultural system. But, for instance, the person in France, we can basically set up shop in France like we did here in a matter of a week. We did this during the Olympics in 2012, a small demonstration in downtown London. And we're kind of going back and forth. Dan and I spent a lot of time. So if we can do it in a city of, 7 or 8 million, plus another 5 or 10 million visiting, and we fed 125 people at a conference with tomatoes, lettuces, radishes. That time we did it all in 45 days.
And how did they enjoy that?
It was all gone. And the last session was held at the St. Regis Hotel in London. And someone came up to us and said, "Is there any more?"
Right.
So for us to be a success is to be out of lettuce, and we're that way all summer with our customers. Things like that. We also did it at Greentown at Notre Dame last year.
Where
the DoubleTree Hotel, we provided the lettuce for the event for 350 people, and it was the only locally grown. This was in middle of October. It was the only locally grown vegetables provided. Because we're 30 miles north.
Sure.
Right?
Yep. I remember my life at Notre Dame, and I'm sure that Vince remembers his at Cornell in Ithaca, and the winters were the best time to go study because there was nothing else to do. they had a winter festival at Cornell. Notre Dame didn't have that.
All we do in the wintertime is grow fresh vegetables.
Right.
So can I ask you a little bit more about your racks? I see one behind you. Do you have just one running down the length of the building?
They're sectionalized into 6 VGS per run, if you will. So
we're going to get another view.
We're going to see it here. Look at that.
Here we go.
And that's just the way that it was. Look out there.
I know.
Careful.
And that's just really the way that the building allowed us to lay it out. We have that a specific aisle, distance between rows so we can maneuver and harvest in the rows. That's basically how it works.
Two rows, right? Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rows, and then the row behind Dan, and we're in an aisle.
Okay.
Got it.
And at the ends, there are some red racks. What are those?
Oh, let's go. Pink LEDs. How am I doing on locating that? Am I okay?
You're looking great.
Excellent.
So what?
Well, those are Illumitex LEDs.
Illumitex, yes.
Yeah. We've been trialing their F3 ES2 bars since February. And it's the future of indoor horticultural lighting, in my opinion.
Can
you guys hear me all right because the camera's...
How do they compare with the induction lamps?
The footprint is easier. You know, we can get the racks, the distance between light and plants can be shortened.
Because of the heat?
Well, the heat and also the spread. So with induction, you have a certain height to spread your light.
That's
so
true.
You get even par levels. But this is built in because those diodes are specifically located, you know, along the rack.
Right.
But our yield increased by 38%.
38%.
So right behind you, Daniel, those are also some of those in the red, directly behind you?
Those are all induction.
They are all induction. They are
different. No, he means to the far...
Yes, those are induction.
Far in. Oh, that's right. I can see the white light underneath that. That's
so
right.
Those are growing also, or...?
Yes.
Okay.
And what about energy utilization compared, if you can, per rack using an induction light or the Lumitex? How do you compare on that level?
Okay. I'd like to give you the long answer on this. We know we could have done it with half the amount of bars that we use now with the Lumitex. We could have grown lettuce.
Got it.
But we wouldn't have been able to grow the same yield as induction. So for us, electricity is we can get electricity with a turbine or a panel, right? But it's a lot harder to get more space. So we wanted to make sure we could get the same yield with the same electricity or less.
Right.
And we're 80 watts less per level, 320 watts less per system with the LEDs, and our yield is higher.
Right.
That's great. And so your profit margin would go up as a result, unless the cost of the LED lights were such that it prevented that from happening.
Right, right, and that's not the case.
Yeah, it's about the same campus.
We've got Chris on our list for interview, by the way, at Illumitech, so we'll get to him. So be careful what you say.
So, Daniel, does your engineering background help you?
Well, I mean, it was the only thing I really engineered was computers. You know, I built a lot of computers, and that's helped me with a lot of the technical aspects, I would think, with growing. A lot of people have a notion that growing is you throw something in soil or dirt and then you water it and there's a plant. But, you know, as you guys know, it can be very, very technical, especially in hydroponics. So dealing with pH and meters and then the control systems, I mean, that helped a lot. Yeah. I don't know.
So I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about selling the produce. Is it, do you mainly sell locally? Is it all go to Chicago? Where does it go?
Chicago. Mm-hmm. We sell to one restaurant, Nana's, in Chicago right now. And Chicago is 65 miles. So local for us is a 100-mile radius from where
right.
we are.
Right.
The majority goes to the local supermarket that is in New Buffalo, and then the Michigan City, Indiana, like South Bend area of Michigan. Mm-hmm. And we sell to Martin Supermarkets, which goes up towards St. Joseph, Michigan. Which
oh, nice.
Is, so we're slowly spreading out. And then once we hit the point
like the lead.
Where we can't be local this farm, then we'll start another farm to be local.
So how do you ship? Do you have your own trucks or do you rent trucks?
We do it all ourselves. Yeah, everything.
Oh.
The other aspect of this model, Dan touched on it, we'll build farms where there's, you know, where we're close to.
Yeah.
And we basically the day after we got back from London or Nottingham, we signed an agreement to build a farm in Medina, Ohio.
Nice.
With a joint venture partner. It's a 35,000 square foot building. We're going to have at least 50 VGSs operational there, hopefully by the end of the year. We are also finishing with the general contractor on the first vertical farm in Detroit, Michigan.
It's
Very small, I think, Dan, 10?
10 to start, yeah.
10 units to start out of how many?
37 in total.
37 in total with a good friend of mine, Jeff Adams, and he formed a company called Artesian Farms. And
nice.
Powered by Green Spirit Farms. So we already have a commitment from two new restaurants that are coming online in Detroit. and I think that's going to be great. But we worked with them. They helped them. I helped them locate a building. Dan's been working with them for all the environmental controls inside. So the first vertical farm in Detroit, Greenspear Farms with Artesian Farms, and we're real pleased with what we're doing in Ohio, because Ohio came to us. We didn't seek out that location.
Oh, that's great.
Part of it, Dick, I hate to say this, part of it was they bought the book, and they said, how do we learn how to do this? And literally, they called us.
Wow.
So what's the square footage of that current facility?
This facility in New Buffalo?
Yeah.
In total, it's 18,000?
18,000. 18,000 square feet. The two cubes that we're in right now, and there's two more cubes that are 18,000 square feet. Mm-hmm. So total building size is about 42,000, just under an acre.
And what's the carrying capacity? You know, like, say, per square foot, what do you, tonnage per year would be?
Well, let's put it this way. Using outside acres, if you would.
Yeah.
We would be about 10 times, okay. 10 times the same acreage. Dan can give you the actual numbers, but I'll give you an idea. One of these units back here, if it's growing basil, it's different, but I'll use lettuce. Lettuce one is at the end. Does about 100 pounds per VGS, and we get 17 harvests a year out of one of those racks. That's 17 pounds, 15 to 1,700 pounds.
That's great.
And then multiply that by 100 for lettuce. GSs. And since the basil is cut and come again, and that's being done, but each basil plant produces well over half an ounce of leaf only. So it's a great
per
harvest. And we harvest that 9 or 10 times, and then we cut the plant and replant it.
Wow.
All scheduled. So what you're looking at per acre, and to give you some quick statistics, we grow the acre equivalent for romaine lettuce in about 4,500 square feet.
Amazing. Right?
And, yeah, good stuff. Good stuff.
500 square feet. And if you were growing that in California today and using water, if you can get it,
right.
You would be using just over 1.5 acre feet of water, or about 500,000 gallons, maybe more, depends who you talk to. But UC Davis says, 1 acre romaine grown in California is around 700,000 gallons of water, and takes 65 days.
Good heavens.
Right, so we're doing 21 days in the VGS, and if you break it down on a per romaine head, that's 6.5-7 gallons for one head of romaine coming from California.
Right.
If you grow that same romaine in Arizona, which they do in the wintertime, you use 1.5 million gallons to grow that
head. Oh my gosh.
Now, again, that's a University of Arizona number.
Because of the low humidity.
Right, and that's 25 gallons per one head of romaine.
Goodness.
Wait for it. Greenspear Farm head of romaine is, thanks to Dan, is 0.3 gallons.
Amazing. So do you sell everything that you grow?
Yes.
Yes.
Right now we're adding capacity. And adding capacity means you have to go raise capital. That's sort of why you don't see me a lot of conferences.
And what is your rate of survival of 100 plants that you put into the rock wall? How many are successful?
In our model, we have projected a 95% success rate.
95. And how does that compare to outdoor farming?
Well, this year.
yeah, they didn't get anything. That's true.
Yeah, I mean it's.
But you've got no pests to worry about. Is that correct?
We don't have any pests. There's always the potential for that to be a problem.
Sure.
So we try to prevent that. So it's always better to prevent the problem from occurring, you know, than trying to tackle it once it's been a problem.
So you got another degree in public health. Is that the idea?
So tell us the ways that you prevent pests from getting into the facility.
Okay, so the simplest way is to have employees have a locker room so they can change the clothes before they hit the farm floor.
Yep.
We live in a very rural area, so pests are a bigger threat to us than, say, you know, Gotham Greens on the top of a skyscraper. And a lot of people who come to visit the farm are farmers who were just on a farm or a greenhouse. So we make sure that if they come in, we have glass windows that they can look at the farm and we can talk to them, but we only let them in the farm on special occasions.
Perfect. Perfect.
Milan, what do you got there?
What you see here is there's 200 bok choy plants.
Oh, right.
Right? So these are the seedlings. I think it's bok choy.
It's kale.
No, it's bok choy.
Is it?
Yep. Right next to the kale. Now, our nursery is, I had to run to the other side. Our nursery is also vertical. So What we have is we have on one shelf, we probably have 4,000 to 5,000 plants growing like this at any given time, times 10. So we got 40,000 to 50,000 seedlings growing to support this operation. But this is 200 seedlings. This is a sheet of rock wool. And, excuse me, Dan, I'm going to show them because the because we're on the TV. So that comes out, right?
And that's cool. It's a plug of bok choy.
Bok choy, correct.
Very nice.
Into the board, and there's 256 of those per tray, times four is 1,016.
Wow.
So at what point do those go into the racks?
They spent about 11 days in our nursery.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Do your baby plants eat the same as your adult plants?
We give them enough to sustain them in the nursery, but they feed less at a you know.
Sure.
So for instance, our lettuce will be, you know, depending on variety, 1.2 to like a 1.8 EC. When we see them, we soak the rock wool with a 0.5 EC solution. Just enough, real mild and basic, just enough to get them going. Because the endosperm has a lot of the nutrition, you know, in the early stages of seedling development.
That's the nutrient-laden other part of the plant besides the embryo. Is that what you meant to say? Endosperm, that's like a, you know, a plant person term.
Sorry.
And we're the worst guys to go out to dinner with. What happens is people look at what we're looking at. So obviously we're ordering the appetizer, we're getting the lettuce, and if there's a kale, there's a blue scotch, is a red Russian, let's taste it. Boy, this, you know, this one, where this came from, why are they buying this crap, you know.
So how much more capacity can you put into that building?
We can little over double what we're doing now.
Uh-huh. And you said there was a second building attached to it, right? Is that also operational at the moment?
It needs a lot of renovation.
Okay.
This part that we're in now was an addition to the original Plastic Masters. I think, I believe, in the 90s.
1999 it was built.
So this was easy for us to get in and get started.
Okay.
And then eventually we'll fix up the back and move into there.
So that building, those buildings you have right there, without any buildings anywhere else in the country, is that sustainable in the long term?
It's all based on rent per square foot. We've been working with the city of New York. We've evaluated several locations. We've been working with the New York City EDC.
Yeah, they're good people.
And we think we have four or five buildings that match our model. We're working on, and I think they're either city-owned or, so we're matching what that rent could be in New York City, because we had a demonstration farm in Northeast Pennsylvania for 8 or 9 months because the rent was too high in New York City. Mm-hmm. But that farm outside of Scranton was targeted for New York City. So we could take this model if the rent is reasonable, because that's what drives everything. Be inside of a building and have our first harvest in 90 days. No special infrastructure, nothing. We build the racks ourselves. You know, Dan puts the valving together. We have crews that do it, obviously. Everybody learns by doing, right?
Sure.
But with this model, we're working with a group in Southern California right now, looking at a big building. We're with another group, you know, looking at another building in an area that's going to surprise a lot of people. We do the assessments. And the assessments start with, what do the buildings look like? What does it cost to rent? And from there, then, each one of these vertical growing stations, we know precisely what it costs from a cost of goods sold model, right? Mm-hmm. It's a self-contained growing system. And Dan, you know, strings 6 to 10 of them together with one dosing system, and that's off the shelf. So really what we've done is done some innovation that we've worked on, but others have helped with, by asking, why don't you do this? Or have you tried that? After you get the lighting stuff figured out, it's about the business of vertical farming. That's really what it is, and the supply chain, and making sure that it tastes good. You know, these are the things that I spoke about at the University of Arizona on the short course when I spoke. It's about the business of vertical farming, not the technology. Right.
Where do you guys get your seeds from?
Mostly Johnny's Select Seeds.
And we get some from
Seeds
of Maine.
They're out of Maine, I believe. Yeah, Seeds of Change out of Compton,
California.
Also, I have got some seeds from some local seed savers, heirloom, and they're all organic seeds. We source only organic seeds, no GMO or crops.
Could you go into the seed business yourself, part of it?
Oh, I have a kale plant that grew outside.
I knew I struck a raw nerve when I said that.
I believe it would be possible. But again, that's a whole nother business that's true.
The ninth richest person in the world was from Thailand, and he made his fortune selling seeds. And a lot of other people did too, but I found out the reason why he was so successful is because all of his seeds germinated. You know, a lot of others didn't. So it's a big worry about throughout the globe. Everybody's worried about where our plants are going to come from, and you know, they've been monocultured to the extent now there are three or four sources for tomatoes, two sources for pickles, and that sort of thing. The diversification of farming by the indoor method is the solution to that problem.
Yes,
definitely.
And Dan's done some of that. Dan's taken, you know, the plant characteristics that we like and have cloned some different varieties of plants. Stevia being one. We grew stevia from seed, and we grew it for a couple of years. And the characteristics we liked of that stevia, because the seeds are really expensive as well.
Right.
Put those together. We're able to get a good stevia plant. We have stevia growing. We take some of our stuff that we don't want to get rid of inside, and we move it outside to the outside of the farm, and we plant it outside in soil. And we let the community come in and take the stevia. We have sage out there. We've got oregano. We've got basil. We've got dill. We have tomatoes, sweet neat tomatoes that we planted in, I believe, October, that are still growing outside.
And the benefit of that, too, is something you touched on earlier, is taste, you know. So we can show people that we have grown the exact thing outside.
Right.
With organic practices. And then you can try the stuff we grew inside, the same packet.
Which
one tastes better.
And from a tissue analysis standpoint, they're almost identical, because we do tissue analysis.
Sure.
But we also do tissue analysis on all of our competition as well.
Oh, nice.
And we want to make sure that we are growing things. Yeah. I mean, we need that to know about the NPK and the micronutrients. But when you look at the what we do and what the organic farmers do in California, it's identical.
So I was at a meeting a long time ago with Gene Giacomelli when I first met him. It was at California Poly in Pomona. And it was attended by the Secretary of Agriculture from the state of California. And I believe his name was Kawasaki. And they actually questioned Gene's ability to raise tasty tomatoes. And Gene had a perfect answer. He reached into his briefcase and pulled out seven beautifully ripened indoor tomatoes. And he said, well, if you want to see how they taste, I've brought some with me. And he divided them among the group and cut them with a paring knife. I think he had a Swiss Army knife with him. And they served them on these paper plates, and everybody was eating them. And I said, do you have any more? it was quite a moment in time.
And I've tasted his tomatoes, because obviously I was there this
sure.
summer.
Sure, they're outstanding, aren't they?
And they're fabulous, and there's a reason why. And when they tasted our tomatoes for the same reason, we do the same thing.
Right.
We'll go to a meeting, a marketing meeting, or we'll go to a conference.
Yeah.
And if we're not doing the salad, right, but we'll bring our own stuff. And but Dan grows tomatoes that taste like tomatoes too. And that's the key. You have to know how to grow. And Gene does a great job. As a matter of fact, I was in the greenhouses for a little bit longer than I should have been, but I just ate from one end to the other.
Yeah.
Test different varieties. So
fantastic.
Yeah, you're right, Dick. I mean, it's you can do it. We can do it.
Oh yeah.
So you talked a little bit about places in Ohio and Detroit, New York, California. So for the future, is that what your plan is? Do you intend to spread all over the U.S.? And if so, you guys can't do all that, right? So how will that work?
Well, we have a few partners.
Mm-hmm.
And partners are equity investors. The equity investors and the people that are contacting us to do farming are large users of vegetables, or are purveyors of vegetables that want security, food transparency, and food sovereignty in that supply chain. So what we're doing is we're training trainers.
Mm-hmm.
Here. We'll be doing that in Detroit. The thing about the Detroit farm that I'm excited about is it's going to be a training center, food hub, that allow us, and we're on the bus route. You can ride your bike to work. You can ride. It's going to be in the Brighton neighborhood. Brightmore neighborhood. So we're going to be able to train those people. We were going to be working in Pennsylvania under a job training grant with the state of Pennsylvania in Keystone.
Yeah.
developing a curriculum. We already sort of have a disciple in Dennis. So Dennis, who was at Delaware Valley College, now has his own sort of vertical farming operation.
Veggie systems,
right, Dennis? And he was doing the Veterans Organic Training Program. So we know, we have a curriculum, we have standard operating procedures, so it's in our best interest to share that with everybody, but sure, basically have a new type of agriculture, and that's what we're doing. So on all these opportunities, we're basically bringing a turnkey approach. Turnkey meaning the financing is being brought in by the partner, we're setting it up, we're doing the training, and University of Arizona was here last week, Dr. Kubota was here.
Oh, yeah, sure.
With Purdue University and Michigan State University,
nice.
We were talking about opportunities to develop internship programs to actually understand controlled agricultural vertical farming more. So, and that came out of obviously when I was at Arizona. So Cherry got the guys together, brought them to Buffalo. So they were here for about 2 or 3 hours to pick our brains as a grower, but also to try to take the academic side of this,
sure,
with our commercial side, and say, let's develop a curriculum together. Because we're going to need people, right?
Very
and that's
true.
What schools are doing as well. I mean, Penn State has a program like that.
That's right.
Well, so I think, and it lends its way across the country as we deploy this, it lends itself to the technical and community college training certificate programs, right? Because you don't necessarily need to be a horticulturalist to do what we do back here, right? We'll teach you everything you need to know. Dan's got it down to sheets and procedures, pictures, videos.
Nice.
So we're going to be more farm development, I guess, rather than just have one single farm, you know. But I think that helps everybody else who thinks they want to do this, and that's really what you have to really think about.
Here, here.
It's something that's time has come. Weather, obviously, we can't count on it to be consistent year to year to year. But we need to be growing vegetables where the people are.
So, will you always have a facility like the one there in New Buffalo, or will you eventually move to teaching people only how to do it?
I think we'll always keep this one because Dan's got too much stuff going on here. Dan's got research and development, this, that. Now, he didn't talk about the strawberries that he was growing last year.
Oh.
He grew local strawberries. They were fabulous. People said, why don't you grow more? And we can grow more, but then that's a 100,000 square foot building.
Right.
And it takes a bit longer, right? Just like with the tomatoes. So now we're going from that 10 to 20,000 square foot model to that 2 to 300,000 square foot model, based on somebody who wants it local to feed a population. I think, Dick, you challenged your students to come up with a system to feed 50,000 people, or, right? So what we're looking at, like in Chicago, for instance, we're looking at two other locations with a joint venture partner to be north, south, and then have New Buffalo be repurposed for in-state purposes. Go to Grand Rapids, maybe go up to Shore Lake, Michigan. We're on a great transportation route, so all those California vegetables that are coming into Michigan, they have to drive right past exit one. They have 1,850 miles behind them.
That's right.
Before they exit one.
That's right.
1,950 miles, create green collar jobs in New Buffalo, Michigan, and most of the people that work at this farm. Dan lives in New Buffalo. I do. Most people that work here live within 10 miles of the farm.
Nice. So Costco has a lot of flat roofs, and Walmart has a lot of flat roofs, and a bunch of other places do too. Have you thought about partnering with any of those larger organizations to become their purveyor?
I can tell you we've had conversations with one of those organizations.
Okay. No, enough said. I think we did talk about this in Nottingham over a few pints, as it were. So
But the idea there, Dick, right, is Dan's got to prove we can do it from a technical standpoint.
Right.
So he has been growing for instance, he's been growing strawberries, right, but now he's growing raspberries.
Raspberries.
Doing that in conjunction with a soil farmer that came to us out of Oxnard, California, saying, we have customers and they're larger stores, and we ship all of our stuff east.
Right.
And we be located. Do you think you can do this? So the nice challenge that I'm very proud of my son, I say, hey, do you think you can do this? He goes, well, sure. He goes, we're going to make any money. So there, that didn't happen a year ago. So now, when we're looking at growing new things with better lighting, with better techniques, where the people are at, right? So now, like Dan said earlier, we deal with soil farmers. And those soil farmers are such a wealth of knowledge. We had a conversation when we started the process. of a local raspberry farmer who's a retired NFL referee, of all things.
Huh.
Up in St. Joseph, Michigan, in Berrien County, who was decimated last year because of the bad winter.
Oh, yeah.
Cold,
yeah. Yeah, so we're taking his knowledge. Dan's adapting it to growing it the way that we grow it behind us here. And we're not there yet, but what we'll see is, you know, can we cut off the grow time, flowering time? What are they? We know they're going to taste good.
Right.
But then what does that mean for a layout of a new farm? It all has to have a different section.
Yeah, yeah.
That leafy greens, right? The leafy greens have to have a different section, the flowering plants. So it's all the logistics inside the farm that makes the logistics outside of the farm successful.
Here, here. So let's talk a minute about flowering plants. It seems to me that a lot of them require pollination. A lot of it is by wind outdoors, you know, like for trees, for instance. But a lot of other fruit-bearing trees and a lot of fruit-bearing bushes require pollinators. Have you thought much about that situation?
Yeah, we have. And there's certain things that we've done without pollinators with a lot of wind movement in the tray using small, you know, 5 mile per hour fans.
Okay.
To get that pollen to kind of have turbidity. But the main reason we hung on to the Omega Gardens is the cherry tomato production with pollination has worked really well. I mean, we haven't had the need for pollinators, but that the head over heels pollination with those gardens is really nice.
And if we do need to pollinate, and I think in the early days we did, I guess Sonicare or any other electric toothbrush, but we use the Sonicare because we go in and hit each plant.
Wow.
And do that. But Dan's right, the Omega Gardens, the Rotary Gardens,
sure.
That pollination, we just did that for the first year to be on the safe side. But those same tomatoes we planted, like I said, in October in the Rotary Gardens, they're outside and been growing ever since. And if you look at the square footage, Dan added verticality to the Rotary Gardens, just like he did back here.
Right.
So we had 480 tomato plants growing in that same 36 square foot footprint, producing close to a pint of tomatoes. And each one of those wheels, if you will, or cylinders, as Ted calls them, Ted Marshall, those cylinders hold
80 plants. 80 plants. The whole system, each cylinder is 200 watt induction lamp, so we're using less wattage than a hair dryer. 480 tomato plants.
Right.
Next is that we'll be taking the tech lights and have a system that
that
place. But what we had to invent, or Dan had to invent, the inset.
The bracket,
The bracket and the inset into that induction lamp because it didn't exist. And we had to take the hood off of an induction lamp because it rotates around, right?
Sure.
Revolution. Yeah.
That's right. But that's right. Yeah,
480 plants, flowering tomatoes, less wattage than a hairdryer.
Amazing. So have you thought much about animal feed as a product rather than human feed?
Yeah, I know there's some guys doing that. Like
there are.
The cat, they have large, and it looks real similar to a nursery kind of scenario.
Yes.
Quick growing grass.
That's right.
And it's a big trend. A lot of people want to get away from corn-fed beef.
Exactly.
You know, and there's a big demand for it. So not only does it make sense to see them from because you're not taking up the grazing land, but also from a marketing fashion, you know. So,
sure.
And that's the best thing about this industry, is it's just everything's possible.
That's true.
And delicious.
So, Daniel, you think you've found yourself a life's profession?
Oh, I hope so. Yeah, it's definitely a passion, and I learned in my college years that the passion is something you can't teach.
It's true.
And I believe in the concepts. I believe in a better world for people. A better world for plants is a better world for people in the end, you know, a better environment. You know, it's all possible. We know what it is we have to do. We just gotta do it.
Did you ever think you'd end up working with your dad?
I like to say I've been working for him since I could pick up a rake.
Milan, what do you think about that? Did you ever think you'd be a partner with your son in a business?
With Dan? Never. I mean, never. it just never entered my mind.
Yeah.
When he was cannibalizing my old computers, if I ever had any computer issues. He was a great kid to have around. But the thing about it is knowledge at the heart of what we're doing here. And to be able to soak up knowledge like Dan does, and to then replicate it. So you learn by doing, right? And that's a lot of stuff we sort of got away from. I mean, I'm 55 years old. But, you know, growing up, my uncle, who was responsible for my interest in this, was a Chicago Public School science teacher. And he taught me how to plant radishes when I was 9 years old. And when I saw the radish grow, I got to pull the radish out and I got to taste it and eat it. And that sort of stuck with me. So now we grow French breakfast radishes in honor of Uncle Stan, but we sell them for $4.
Amazing. Well, clearly you two guys really work well together because you got a beautiful place there and it's going great.
Thank you. It's not just us. It's us here in the past that no longer works here and you guys as well. And I mean, it's... we're just a small part of this.
We've told everyone to be quiet, so I don't know where they went.
Can you get,
I can see somebody in back of
can
you.
Can you get any of them to come by and say hi? We'd love to see them.
Come here. Stephanie, meet Vince and Dick DePommier.
Hey, Stephanie.
Hello, Stephanie.
Hi.
Dick, right?
Stephanie, what do you do?
I'm a horticulturist. I grow plants.
Excellent.
Plants that you can eat, right?
Yep.
That's right.
Do you like it?
I do. I love it. Yeah, it's my passion for sure.
And do those plants taste good?
Delicious.
Great. Well, congratulations. You're doing a great job.
Thank you.
Here comes somebody else.
My best. You know?
Thanks.
Thanks.
Hey there. What's your name?
Boston.
Are you a horticulturist?
Uh-oh.
It'll come back. It's frozen.
You see us?
You guys froze for a second.
Yeah, you did too. Sorry about that.
Yeah, it's a Skype. It's not your fault. It happens. You get so tell us your name again. We missed it.
My name is Boston Weed.
And what do you do there?
I handle the nutrients and the crew here.
Excellent.
Nice. Do you like it?
Oh, I love it.
Do you like the product?
Oh, it's even better. Better for the job, yeah.
And what did you do before you came there?
Oh, I worked for my family's catering business. Uh-huh. I was the head cook for that, and I also bartended.
Nice. Good preparation for this, right?
Fantastic.
That's perfect, actually.
When are you guys going to start growing hops?
Hopefully really soon.
Don't forget the barley also.
That's great. Well, thanks for coming by.
There's somebody else.
Yeah, Becky's a little reluctant to on camera.
Hey, Becky.
Hello, Becky.
What do you do there?
The administrative manager, but I also do planting, delivering, sales.
Are you having a blast?
Everybody else is out doing deliveries. Farm manager Ben Wiggins, tried to do him. We have a couple of former greenhouse, local greenhouse, unfortunately closed down a couple miles from us, and their loss was our gain, and the gals that work for us here, they do a fabulous job. They start up at 8 o'clock.
So how many people altogether work for Green Spirit?
There's probably 12 of us here at this farm. That's all of us.
Terrific.
We'll have 3 or 4 in Detroit. Ohio will probably have 3 or 4. We'll do a lot of the training as that grows. But the nice thing about it is we schedule, and this is when I spoke at San Luis Obispo, UC San Luis Obispo in March. The soil farmers said, well, how do you schedule your harvest? I said, 21 days, we're 21 days into the cycle. We pull the lettuce. We then replant it in the afternoon after cleaning the vertical growing system.
Sure.
No, can you slow down? Okay. So how do you harvest? And I said, pick the lettuce.
So if you plant it every day, you could harvest virtually 24 hours,
And I didn't get it at first. And I said, some of the younger farm technicians get in, and when they come in at the crack of 9 o'clock.
The crack of 9:30.
Right. They've done picking, and we usually like to pick the lettuce first, right, Dan?
Yep.
right? Picking the lettuce first, and then we go on to the kale, the spinach, the basil, placing the orders. Shipping gets done shortly after that.
Wow.
Always cleaning to be done, seeding, planting, and then there's the business of Green Spirit Farms, and that leads you to about 5:30, 5 days a week, no real harvesting on the weekends. So, and the farmers that I spoke to in California, they love that model. They love that model.
Those are banker's hours.
Exactly.
Don't forget Wednesdays you get to take off for golf.
Yeah. It would be nice if we could do that.
Yeah, right.
Nice if we can do that. But the interesting thing is everybody here is cross-trained. So we again, everybody has primary jobs to do, but whatever it takes, we all do it, you know, together, because that's the way it should be. And we talked about this in Nottingham with Paul from Frontier.
Sure.
You know, the employees are the key to this. And like that's Dan said earlier, right, you have to have people. You can't teach passion. People are drawn to working in this environment, but it's the plants, right? It's the right light, nice light. It's the environment, and we find that the plants love music, just no rap. They love it. and maybe that's an owner issue, but I'll
that's right.
Jordy on that one.
Yeah,
that's right. No tattooed plants.
Every once in a while, there's some Copeland when we need to get them sort of towards the end to get them really moving.
Oh, that's nice.
They kind of grade into a little Motown late morning.
Right.
Frank Sinatra comes out in and out almost all day, and it's somebody else's playlist. So whoever has the iPod that plugs it in, that's what plays in the farm.
So if you ever need insects or pollinators, just play Flight of the Bumblebee.
I that was too easy.
You did.
Well, guys, thanks so much for joining us.
We really appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah, well, thanks for having us. And Dick, remember, you're going to come out and see this for yourself, right?
Well, I think Vince wants to come with me. We would like to do a shootout there.
Yeah, cool. And we talked, and just so you know, we talked about with some of the community people because we supply a local distillery with some of their fare.
Yep.
And we thought we might make it into a little bit of an event. And now, if you have to go to the distillery, you'll have to taste what they do. And,
right.
Taste what we grow at the same time. If you're up to that, and we'll put Vince and you down. We're going to try to do that maybe late February, early March.
That'd be delightful.
All right. So, because people here would really like to talk more to you, they seem to like Green Spirit Farms, and they're just really passionate about what we're doing here. We couldn't support our families here in Green Spirit Farms if it wasn't for those families out there that are buying our stuff.
That's great stuff. Well, let's make it happen then.
Okay. Cool.
We've been speaking with Milan and Daniel Kluko of Green Spirit Farms. Thanks, guys, for joining us, and lots of luck.
All right. Thank you. Cheers, guys.
Keep it up, guys. Keep it up.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Did you enjoy that, Dickson?
I loved it.
Now, we have to tell people that Milan and Daniel were inside their farm.
Exactly.
So it's noisy. There's fans blowing. And
that's right.
People working. So you know, we think it's just great that they were willing to put their laptop in there and show us it, right?
Absolutely.
So please excuse the noise. You know, we know normally our sound is pristine and clean, but sometimes when you get out there. But if you have a chance, do look at the video. And I know most of you probably just listen, but it's really great. That was a good one.
Yep.
Be hard to top that, Dickson.
Well, we're going to try.
And those guys are very nice. They're very friendly.
They're accomplished people. They've had some hardships in their own personal lives. They've risen above that, and they've now created a growing industry in their part of the world that's going to spread throughout the country.
You want to read two emails?
Sure.
Sure, let's just, because we have a lot.
Well, this is all good.
And
Why don't you start?
First one's from Nick. Dear Dickson and Vincent, I am a student that is about to embark on a master's in food security and sustainable agriculture.
Uh-huh.
And I gratefully stumbled across your podcast and have been enjoying it ever since. Keep them coming.
We will try our best.
I have one question I'm hoping you would be able to address. With agriculture in an urban environment, especially those inside buildings, how will it benefit from various ecosystem services that conventional agriculture relies on, things such as pollination, nutrient dispersal, etc.?
Right.
I imagine that have a greater diversity of plants within the system will help this to a degree, but I was just wondering what your thoughts were. Thanks for your time, and keep up the good work.
That's a great question, by the way, and it's an open-ended question.
We touched a little bit about it on it today, right?
We did, and so did Milan, and he was mentioning the lack of agricultural runoff and the need to fertilize and to use lots of water outdoors. So those are potentially recovered ecological settings that if you didn't farm on those settings and just neglected them, so to speak, in a benign way, they would eventually grow back to what they used to be, which mm-hmm. in most cases turns out to be hardwood forest. Those repopulate very fast by windblown seeds from all over the place, and birds help to distribute seeds as well. The next thing you know, you're looking around and you see that forest over there that used to be a farm. Remember early on in our discussion, we mentioned this wonderful journal kept by Aldo Leopold called Sand County Almanac. And the Sand County Almanac actually is a description of his father's abandoned Wisconsin farm, which turned back into a woods. So that's ecosystem services and functions for both the rest of life on Earth and for humans as well. Carbon sequestration is best done by trees. That's the way that works. And in fact, I just heard something on NPR this morning on my local NPR station, because this is a big issue at the United Nations right now with regards to climate change issues. And we've had a lot of protests around the world in most major cities, mostly consisting of younger people who are concerned about the health issues raised by the fact that the Earth has been taking a turn for the worse in terms of the atmosphere filling up with carbon dioxide, et cetera, et cetera. So allowing a farmland that currently is in use to eventually revert back to forest has a value, and that value is not fully expressed by the governments that are in control of the subsidies for farms and stuff like this. But if it were given its true value of a recovering forest, of an ex-farmer could make more money allowing the trees to grow back than they could growing corn every year, for instance. So that's my hope, is that eventually this indoor farming technology will make it obvious to everybody that this is a much better way to go in terms of raising food and allowing nature to take care of itself outdoors so that our lives will be better at all levels. That's, you know, idealistic, but that's what drives my passion for this topic, and I will continue to do so for as long as I'm alive.
I'm actually amazed that people are doing this, like guys like that.
I thought you would be, because I know that this has been theoretical up to this point.
They have risked their livelihoods.
Yes, they have.
To do this.
Yes, they have.
You better be sure of this.
It's not in my hands anymore, Vincent. You know it's not.
I don't know how you can sleep at night, to be
honest. I sleep very soundly at night, thank you.
You want to read the one from David, please? Do you have glasses? No, you can't read it.
I might be able to read it anyway.
Well, not, might is no good.
Well, let's just see. If not, you can edit the whole thing out. How's that?
Oh, that's too much work.
So David writes, "Hello, Profs DePomye and Racaniello. I'm a postdoc working down the road at NYU Medical Center in structural biology. I've been listening to the Twix podcasts for quite some time and wanted to thank you for the enlightening shows. They elucidate me to other aspects of biology and make the day go faster as I run experiments. In particular, I'm enjoying the new urban agriculture podcast. I must admit that on days of nothing but negative data, I am tempted to leave science and go start a farm." That's great. "I did have one question about the vertical farm model. I was curious that a few of the existing vertical farms Professor DePomye mentioned had no windows, but rather the plants were grown with artificial lighting. Isn't this a rather expensive production method, both economically and environmentally, requiring lots of electricity? This would seem to limit these types of urban farms to particularly profitable fruits and vegetables, or to locations where power is cheap. I wonder if the ideal vertical farm isn't tall and narrow with glass walls to maximize sun exposure. Apologies if you're going to get to this in a later podcast. I am always impatient for the next show, so please keep up the great work, David." Well, indeed, we do have a podcast coming up in which I plan on interviewing the CEO for Illumitex, which manufactures LED grow lights. And I'd like to wait for that explanation to come from the mouths of commercial producers of grow lights and how they justify the expense for this technology. But in brief, I can promise you, David, that if you were to ask that question 5 years ago, I would have to give you a different answer than I'm giving you today. 5 years ago, you would have been absolutely right on the money. And in fact, it would be totally impractical to use any kind of indoor lighting scheme to offset the cost of growing vegetables indoors. The efficiency of lights in those days was down around 28% at most. So the electricity costs here, it's 10 cents a kilowatt, for instance, in New York City, and that usually is it's true throughout the country. Those prices would not permit you to use indoor lighting, and you'd have to go to a transparent building, as you suggested. But today, the efficiency of LED lights for growing plants indoors has jumped up to 68%. And that's a huge improvement in electrical usage. That means you can save three times the amount of money and invest that in something else rather than the lights. So I'd like you to hear more about that, though, from the people that actually manufacture these fixtures for these growing systems. There is now a burgeoning industry for grow lights indoors. And because we're seeing more and more application indoors, it's becoming cheaper because more people are using them. And it's just like the prices of cell phones or plasma screen televisions or airline tickets. It's all the same. The moment you start using more of something and industry gets wind of it, they will attempt to fill that need. And that's just exactly what's happening right now. So I'm very encouraged by the near future of this technology.
Is it going to get better than 68%?
It's theoretically possible, according to physics that I've heard from physicists, that it could be 100% efficient. Now imagine an LED light that converts all of the electrons to photons without any loss in resistance because perhaps they've allowed the electricity to go through a superconductor, for instance, which has no frictional aspect to it. So those ideas are on the books, and they're working on these now, and I'm sure Philips and GE and those kinds of companies are maybe they have working models that are already existing. They're not talking about that, but so it could be even higher than it is now. But if you go to a country like Iceland, as we've mentioned this before, there's a country that doesn't care how much electricity anything costs because they've got geothermal energy to create steam to make the turbines run to create the electricity. So everybody in Iceland gets their homes heated free, which I think is remarkable. But of course, you have to sit on top of a volcano for that to happen. That's not typically the case anywhere else.
Jim writes, this may be too far afield from growing food, but I was impressed with the data presented in this free government document that I just discovered, and I'm sending it to everyone who might find it useful. Sends a link to a document called Transportation Energy Data Book. I was surprised that in one chart, Texas was second to California in the number of electric refueling stations it provided. The numbers are in the low thousands, but far ahead of other states. It's a matter of mass. There are more people in California and Texas than anywhere else in the U.S.
Plus,
right?
They have a lot of sunlight. If you look at Tesla's business model, by the way, if you buy a Tesla sedan right now and they're expensive, they're up around $75,000 per car, the refueling is free. He's created a series of refueling stations all the way across the country. And for the life of that car, you get free electricity from that. And those are all solar-generated power
stations.
Are you
buying a Tesla?
I wish I could. I would own one if I could.
Neva writes, Drs. DePommier and Racaniello love this podcast. I hope to visit the Vertical Farm in Chicago soon.
Great.
What's the name of that, Dickson?
Well, there are two, actually. That's farmed here. Of course, that's a commercial operation in Bedford Park. But the one called The Plant, inside the city limits in the Stockyards District, is available to the public. And it's run by a man by the name of John Adele. And we plan on having him on one of our podcasts as well. So that would be a great place to start.
Thought you might find this article of interest. She sends a link to an article in the Technology Review called How LEDs Are Set to Revolutionize High-Tech Greenhouse Farming.
Bingo.
They are, aren't they?
They
so we're
going to
talk with some of the movers and shakers in LED technology,
you
right?
You bet. And there was a big article in Forbes magazine about that too. And they ended up concluding that based on recent developments, the answer is they're very practical now.
Neva is from Buda, Texas.
Nice.
One more from Simon. Dear Professor DePommier, you and your colleague, Professor Racaniello, have a lot to answer for. You think they were just writing to you, huh? Your podcasts are so interesting and your passion for your areas of expertise so infectious that every time I listen to you, I feel inspired to change my career. I first discovered This Week in Virology and immediately wanted to become a virologist. My wife has since forbidden me from working with viruses, plus I feel that my complete lack of formal biology training could prove to be a hurdle. By way of TWIV, I came across This Week in Urban Agriculture. Well, it's just urban agriculture.
Right.
And just one episode in, I already want to dedicate myself to urban farming. Indeed, as I made my way home while listening to the podcast, I found myself looking around at all the space in the city available for cultivating plants.
Nice.
I grew up in a suburban house with a garden, but now find myself living in an apartment in one of the most populous cities of the world, Mexico City.
Oh, my.
As a kid, I quite often grew my own fruits and vegetables, tomatoes, lettuce, cucumbers, and a range of herbs. And in the past couple of years, I found myself missing the garden and the opportunity to produce fresh, homegrown produce. I started by using old yogurt and margarine containers for growing basil, cherry tomatoes, and even chilies, but have found the upkeep to be quite trying at times. I am now working on a do-it-yourself project to build a basic deep water hydroponic system.
Nice.
I think one of the things that attracts me to the idea of urban farming is how easy it is for anyone to get involved, whereas areas such as virology or parasitology, while fascinating, require quite significant education and training in order to truly participate.
That's true.
Pretty much anyone can start to grow things at home. I am a passionate home cook, and I love the idea of being able to cook with my own fresh produce, which often tastes far better than anything I can buy at the supermarket, unless it's from Green Spirit.
Exactly. Right?
My first intention with this email was to introduce myself and to say thank you so much for once again sharing with the world your knowledge, passion, and experience. Your conversations and explanations are so clear and engaging that my only regret is not to have been able to be a student in one of your classes. But you can take my classes online at Coursera or iTunes University. Right, Dickson?
Absolutely.
Have you taken my classes? No.
Well, I've participated in them.
You're not interested, are you?
I've read several
articles discussing the various merits of different types of agriculture, with people claiming that hydroponics in general is a more efficient or productive system than traditional soil-based farming, and that aeroponics is even more productive.
I wondered
if you had any comments on these claims and whether in a future podcast you may discuss the different methods of urban agriculture and their relative pros and cons.
That's a great idea, and we will.
Haven't we somewhat?
We have.
Not in great detail, though.
But we're trying to get the growers on to actually give us numbers of percentages increase in water use or not water use and productivity, et cetera. So we're working on a program which will solidify these ideas into concrete thought patterns.
Well, you heard today that the efficiency of this hydroponic farm is much more than soil-based. He gave us the numbers.
He did.
And now
so
aeroponics.
That's one good example.
Are we going to find anyone doing aeroponics?
Well, absolutely. There's one company establishing a aeroponic farm in Newark as we speak.
All right.
As soon as they get fully set up, we're going to go over there.
Will they let us?
Ed Harwood and I are very good friends.
Let us?
You know, that deserved a tomato.
I know that one of your goals is education. You may like to know that you now have another dedicated subscriber who has already started recommending your podcast to anyone who will listen.
Nice.
In the meantime, I would love to be able to help in any way that I can, particularly if you require any assistance with the web design and or development side of things.
Oh.
Thank you. And I'm looking forward to the next podcast on this fascinating and incredibly important subject. Well, we will keep you in mind. For sure.
Indeed.
Because you never know when we need some help, right?
You don't. You don't.
And that will do it for this episode of Urban Agriculture. You can find us at urbanag.ws. We're also on iTunes.
We are.
Right, Dickson?
We are.
And we love getting your questions and comments. You can send them to urbanag@urbanag.ws.
Right.
My co-host here at Urban Agriculture is called Dickson Despommier.
For lack of a better term.
You can find him at verticalfarm.com. Thank you, Dickson.
You're very welcome, Vincent. You do a great job of managing this show, and I'm deeply appreciative.
We had a good show today. It was fun.
It was excellent. It was totally excellent. I mean, this is the nuts and bolts of vertical farming. From a classroom project in 1999 to a fully functional vertical farm in 2014, doesn't get better than that.
I'm Vincent Racaniello. You can find me at virology.ws. The music that you hear on the beginning and end of Urban Agriculture is composed and performed by Ronald Jenkins and John Harrison with the Wichita State University Chamber Players. Ronald Jenkins' work is at ronaldjenkins.com. You've been listening to Urban Agriculture. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. You don't know what to say, do you? See you upstairs at the Vertical Farm.
I'll see you upstairs at the Vertical Farm.